فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. We are in the explanation of the book ثلاثة الأصول, written by شيخ الإسلام محمد بن عبد الوهاب رحمه الله تعالى. We are on the third مقدمة. We finished two مقدمات, and إن شاء الله تعالى today we're gonna go into the third مقدمة. This مقدمة, the author, he says, اعلم أرشدك الله لطاعته أن الحنيفية ملة إبراهيم أن تعبد الله وحده مخلصا له الدين. This statement of the author, اعلم أرشدك الله, is as follows. اعلم, know, have knowledge. And the author has been using this very often. أرشدك الله, may Allah guide you. And this is تلطف. Again, the Sheikh three times consecutively, he's showing kindness, mercy, tenderness in his approach. أرشدك الله, may Allah تبارك وتعالى guide you to. And the usage of these types of terminologies and words and dealings with people, what it does is يجعل قلب المتعلم قابلا للعلم. It makes the person you're teaching become attentive, open-minded, ready to observe, absorb and accept the message that you put forward to them. The person becomes munfatihan muqbilan alayhi. He faces towards you. He wants to hear what you have to say. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala guide you. In what? Lita'atihi, his obedience. We respond by saying, Allahumma ameen. This dua goes to the qari, the one who's reading the book. Not only the one who's reading. Awil mustami', the one who's listening. The word arshadaka, as you can see from the translation, or the way I translated it, it means dallaka wa hadaka ila rushd. May Allah guide you to that which is correct. And rushd means istiqamatu ala tariq al-haq, is to be steadfast upon the straight path. And it is the opposite of al-ghay. Ghay means dalal, misguidance. لطاعته, the word ta'a means muwafaqatu amri shara. It is to be in accordance to the command of the sharia. What does it mean to be in accordance to the command of the sharia? بفعل المأمور, by doing that which it commands you to do. واجتناب المحظور, and staying away from that which it told you to stay away from. And whenever Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala guides a person to that, and he gives him this, this person, فَقَدْ ظَفِرَ بِعِزِّ الدُّنْيَا وَسَعَادَةِ الْآخِرَةِ. Anyone who's given that would truly gain the honor in this world and the happiness of the hereafter. Then the author, rahimahullah, he said, أن الحنيفية ملة إبراهيم. أن الحنيفية ملة إبراهيم. حنيفية is ملة إبراهيم. حنيفية actually means ملة إبراهيم. So why would the author bring حنيفية and then attach it next to ملت إبراهيم, if they're the same thing? This is called عطف بيان. This is called عطف بيان. It's connecting the two, but it's explaining for you what حنفية means. ملت إبراهيم is actually explaining to you that حنفية means ملت إبراهيم. And that's why the author combined between the two for you. So you know when he says Al-Hanafiyyah, he's referring to Millat Ibrahim. The original usage of the word, the original ma'khal, is from the word Hanafi. Hanafi. And the word Hanafi means al-mail, when you divert from something. So the hanif huwa al-mail is the one that's diverted, and shirki, he's diverted from shirk qasdan wa ikhlasan ila tawhid. He's diverted from shirk, associating partners with Allah, by way of intention and by way of sincerity towards, he's diverted from shirk, but towards what? Ila tawhidi, to tawhid. So if something is diverted from something, it means that it's turned towards something else, right? So if it's diverted from shirk, then it means huwa muqbilun ala Allah, the person is turned towards Allah, he's facing towards Allah, he's directed towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But he's turned away from what? Al-mu'ridu an kulli ma siwa. Everything other than Allah, he's diverted from it, and he turns away from it. And that is what Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala commanded for us to be upon. Qala ta'ala, Allah says in Surah An-Nahl, ayah 123, ثم أوحينا إليك أن اتبع ملة إبراهيم حنيفا. And we have sent revelation unto you, أن اتبع, to follow, ملة إبراهيم, the religion of Ibrahim, حنيفا. This is حال. The ملة إبراهيم is a religion that's diverting from shirk, and it is diverted towards at-tawheed. Nabiullah Ibrahim's religion, we know it to be what? It's a religion based upon tawheed, right? That's why Allah said in Surah Az-Zukhruf, ayah 26 to ayah 27, وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ لِأَبِيهِ وَقَوْمِهِ إِنَّنِي بَرَاءٌ مِّمَّا تَعْبُدُونَ إِلَّا الَّذِي فَطَرَنِي فَإِنَّهُ سَيَهْدِينَ. And when Ibrahim said to his father and his people, إِنَّنِي I, بَرَاءٌ, I am free from, مِمَّا تَعْبُدُونَ, that which you worship. إِلَّا الَّذِي فَطَرَنِي, except the one who has created me, who sustains me, who provides for me. فَإِنَّهُ سَيَهْدِينَ, he's the one who is going to guide me. So if you look at this word of Nabiullah Ibrahim, which is إِنَّنِي بَرَاءٌ مِّمَّا تَعْبُدُونَ and إِلَّا الَّذِي فَطَرَنِي, The first part, the shaq al-awwal, the first part of the ayah, which is innani bara'un mimma ta'budun, is nafyu negation, right? The word bara is a negation, right? And if you look at the shaq al-thani, the second verse, I mean the second part, which is illa alladhi fatarani, this is ithbat, affirmation. And that's what tawheed, kalimatu tawheed, is. It stands on those two pillars, nafyun and ithbat, right? You say la ilaha, and then you say illallah, right? And that's what Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, the word which he allowed it to remain after Ibrahim, which Allah says in the ayah, وَجَعَلَهَا كَلِمَةً بَاقِيَةً فِي عَقِبِهِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ. It is the word Allah tabarak wa ta'ala made it remain present fi aqibihi, in the back of Nabiullah Ibrahim. And of course Ibrahim, the word aqib Ibrahim was what? Arab. Now this is going to remain within the Arabs. And Nabiullah Ibrahim actually gave birth to prophets, came from his lineage. So the Shaykh rahimahullah, he took it from that verse. ثُمَّ أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ أَنِ اتَّبِعْ مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ حَنِيفًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says in Surah An-Nahl, ayah 120, إِنَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ, verily Ibrahim, كَانَ أُمَّةً, Ibrahim is a nation alone. قَانِتًا, the word قَانِت is what? الْخَاشِعُ الْمُطِيعُ, the one who is humble and is obedient. Lillahi, to his Lord. Hanifan, one who is diverted from shirk and is diverted towards tawheed. The word millah that the Sheikh uses here, anna al-hanifiyyata millata, it means deen. Millah means religion. It is ism li kulli ma shara'ahu Allah. It's a term for everything which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated li'ibadihi, for his slaves, ala al-sinati anbiya'ihi, on the tongues of his prophets. The statement of the author, an ta'bud Allah, that you worship Allah wahdahu alone. مخلصا له الدين, with ikhlas, sincerity in the religion for him. And we took the definition of ikhlas previously, we spoke about it in other lessons and other books that we have taught, that the haqiqah, the true meaning of the word ikhlas, is إخلاصنا لله صف القلب من إرادة سواه فاحذر يا فطن. إخلاصنا لله صف القلب من إرادة سواه فاحذر يا فطن. إخلاص means, the true meaning of it is when you purify from your heart. إخلاصنا لله صف القلب is when you purify from your heart and you clean your heart. Any intentions, any motives for nobody other than Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Every action that you do it for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Every speech, you do it for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And every motive and intention is for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Wahdahu alone. Lahu deen, the religion is for him. Pay attention. This, أن تعبد الله, that you worship Allah alone, وحده, مخلصا له الدين, in a state of sincerity in the religion for him, this is a clarification and is explaining what is Millatu Ibrahim. So what the author did here right now is very powerful. Are you with me? He brought Al-Hanafiyyah for you. What explains Hanafiyyah for you? Millatu Ibrahim. What explains Millatu Ibrahim? أن تعبد الله وحده مخلصا له الدين. So the word أن تعبد الله وحده مخلصا له الدين, that jumla is a khabaru أن الحنفية, the أن that's in الحنفية is the khabar of it. So the taqdeer is as follows. اعلم know أن الحنيفية, the context it falls like this, لأن because if أن وما دخلت عليه في تأويل مصدر خبر is the خبر of أن, which is اعلم know أن الحنيفية ملة إبراهيم عبادة الله تعالى مخلصا له الدين. It falls in that meaning. What's the أصل of عبادة? Or in simple terms, how many types do the scholars categorize ibadah in? The first categorization is at-ta'abbud, and the second one was al-muta'abbadu bihi, right? At-ta'abbud, we said it is al-tadallul. Huh? It is khudu' and what? Al-hub. But in the original language of the Arabic, the word ibadah, linguistically, in the Arabic language, it actually means khudu'. Ama it means tadallul in the Arabic language. The Arabs, for example, will say tariqul mu'abbad. What do they mean by it when they say tariqul mu'abbad? That what they mean by it is mudallal. What does it mean mudallal? Muhayya' li suluki nas. It's very, huh? It's a land where it's ready for people to walk on it and to tread on it. Huh? And that's why the word ibadah is used for the ahkam of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, the ahkam al-taklifi in which Allah tabarak wa ta'ala burdened on the slaves. That's why it is used as a ibadah. It's because that the slaves, they do it, huh? Because they are ready and prepared, huh? To do it. They, لأنهم يلتزمونها ويفعلونها متذللين خاضعين لله سبحانه وتعالى. But the person does the action for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in a state of complete love and complete humiliation. Both of those two. وَالْمُتَعَبَّدُ بِهِ, which is the second part, is as Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah brought in his Kitab al-Ubudiyyah, page 38, that it is ismun jami'un li kulli ma yuhibbuhu Allah wa yirdah min al-aqwali wal-a'mali al-zahirati wal-batila. It's a general term, everything which Allah tabarak wa ta'ala loves and is pleased with in terms of speech, actions, that which is apparent and that which is within, such as the salah, zakat, siyam, hajj, mahabba, loving, khawf, fearing, raja, hoping, tawakkul, reliance, isti'ana, seeking aid, istighatha, seeking refuge. All of those are what? They are ibadah because they fall under that definition which I gave, or the definition given by Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullahu ta'ala. مُخْلِصًا لَهُ الدِّينِ. And we mentioned what the word مُخْلِصًا means, right? It means sincerely for Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. نعم. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in a hadith, Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim both narrated. On the authority of Utban ibn Malik radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, may Allah be pleased with him subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the Nabiya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qala, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ حَرَّمَ عَلَى النَّارِ مَنْ قَالَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ يَبْتَغِي بِذَلِكَ وَجْهَ اللَّهِ. Allah has made the hellfire haram on the person who says La ilaha illallah, trying to gain the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And anybody who does ikhlas in his ibadah, he does it only for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, Allah will honor you by diverting you from sins and shortcomings. A person of ikhlas, a person of sincerity in his tawheed and his acts of worship, he is honored by being diverted from him sins and shortcomings. Allah says in Surah Yusuf, Ayah 24, كَذَلِكَ لِنَصْرِفَ عَنْهُ السُّوءَ وَالْفَحْشَاءَ إِنَّهُ مِنْ عِبَادِنَا الْمُخْلَصِينَ. And like that, we divert so evil and fahsha, which is zina. إِنَّهُ, verily he was, مِنْ عِبَادِنَا الْمُخْلَصِينَ, he was from our sincere slaves. So the possibility and the reason why Nabiullah Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam, he was diverted from su' and fahsha, is because he was from the sincere slaves of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Alladhina akhlasahumullah, those who were sincere in their speech and in their actions and their intentions. And Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala chose him because of that. Wakhtassahum linafsihi, and he chose him to be one of his messengers. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala tells us also in the Quran, like for example, Surah Al-Hijr, Ayah 42, that the person who comes with sincerity, that Allah will give him a shield from shaitan. Allah says in Surah Al-Hijr, Ayah 42, إِنَّ عِبَادِي لَيْسَ لَكَ عَلَيْهِمْ سُلْطَانِ. Shaitan, you do not have power over my slaves. The slaves that Allah is referring to over here are those who are sincere. What's the evidence that the slaves that are meant here are the sincere ones? The ayah in Surah As-Sad that explains it, Ayah 82 to Ayah 83. Allah says, فَبِعِزَّتِكَ لَأُغْوِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ إِلَّا عِبَادَكَ مِنْهُمُ الْمُخْلَصِينَ. فَبِعِزَّتِكَ, with your honor, O Allah, لَأُغْوِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ, I'm going to misguide each and every one of them. إِلَّا عِبَادَكَ, except your slaves who are, إِلَّا عِبَادَكَ مِنْهُمُ الْمُخْلَصِينَ, except those slaves of yours who are sincere. They're an exception. So Shaytan, with his own mouth, is admitting that he won't be able to misguide the slaves of Allah who are sincere. So Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has placed between him and those slaves a hirz, a shield, a fortress. He's unable to get to them. And also from the benefits that are in ikhlas, that the person will gain if he comes with sincerity in his ibadah for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, is that he is freed from the shackles of servitude to the creation, and he becomes a slave to the master. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him that freedom. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he says, هَرَبُوا مِنَ الرِّقِّ الَّذِي خُلِقُوا لَهُ فَبُلُوا بِرِقِّ النَّفْسِ وَالشَّيْطَانِ. هربوا. They ran away from being slaves to Allah تبارك وتعالى, but they ended up becoming slaves for their own nafs and shaitan. Have you not seen people who are addicted to zina and pornography and haram and things that are haram, and have and they're addicted to alcohol and drugs, and they cry and they just want to leave this cycle because they believe they become weak, they're just crying, they want salvation and prosperity. It's because what's on them is رق النفس والشيطان. Allah says in the Quran, وَمَنْ يَعْشُ عَنْ ذِكْرِ الرَّحْمَانِ نُقَيِّضْ لَهُ شَيْطَانًا فَهُوَ لَهُ قَرِينَ. Shaitan has become his master. And Shaitan will only take him to that which is his destruction. Then the author goes on to saying, وَبِذَلِكَ أَمَرَ اللَّهُ جَمِيعَ النَّاسِ. That word وَبِذَلِكَ that's being used here is an ismu ishara. ذَلِكَ is an ismu ishara, right? The Shaykh is pointing at something. He is saying to us this. Where is it referring back to? Where is it going back to? يَعُودُ إِلَى الْعِبَادَةِ الْخَالِصَةِ. It's going back to the مُخْلِصًا لَهُ الدِّينِ. He says, وَبِذَلِكَ and that, a meaning, the religion, which is the ibadah, which is based on sincerity, أَمَرَ اللَّهُ Allah commanded it. جَمِيعَ النَّاسِ commanded all of mankind. Where's the evidence for that? Where's the evidence for the statement of the Shaykh here? It's in Surah Al-Anbiya, Ayah 25. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَعْبُدُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, we have not sent down before you a messenger except that we have sent a revelation unto him, and that message that was given to him was لَا إِلَهَ, that there is none worthy of worship except Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and worship him alone. So that ayah is an evidence. Ayah 25, Surah Al-Anbiya, is an evidence that ikhlas in ibadah is what Allah has sent down subhanahu wa ta'ala and commanded all of mankind. Sah? Then the author says, وَخَلَقَهُمْ لَهَا. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala created them. Laha, where's that dhamir going to go back to? Where does that pronoun go back to? It goes back to what we were talking about right now, which is the ikhlas, mukhlisan lahu ad-din, the ibadah which is based upon sincerity. That's what it goes back to. Allah created them to worship Him alone with sincerity. And the Shaykh rahimahullah, he brought a verse to prove that. كما قال تعالى, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ, I did not create, الْجِنَّ. Jinn is, it's an عالم, it's a universe, غَيْبِيٌ, unseen universe. قَائِمٌ بِذَاتِهِ, that stands independently. It is different from the human beings. يَخْتَلِفُ عَنِ الْإِنسِ. But how is it different from us? لأنه مخلوق من نار, because he's created from fire. And the ins, the human, is created from what? من طين. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said in Surah Al-Rahman, Ayah 14 to Ayah 15, خلق الإنسان من صلصال كالفخار وخلق الجان من مارج من نار. That Allah tabarak wa ta'ala created the jinn from nar, and that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he created mankind from teen. Why are they called jinn? The reason why they are called jinn is because istitarihim, they are hidden. Anil uyuni, from the eyes. As Allah said in Surah Al-A'raf, ayah 27, إِنَّهُ يَرَاكُمْ هُوَ وَقَبِيلُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا تَرَوْنَهُمْ. He sees you. He sees you whilst you can't see him. And what you need to remember in the Arabic language is that when the letter Jim and the Noon come together, it shows the meaning of a sitr, when something is hidden. This is fi lughati al-Arab, in the Arabic language. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ, I did not create. الْجِنَّ, we spoke about jinn. وَالْإِنْسَ, ins is al-bashar. Ins is plural, and it's a jam'u taksir. The singular is insi. Why is it called ins for? Why are we called ins for? The reason why we're called ins is because لِأَنَّ بَعْضُهُمْ يَأْنَسُ بِبَعْضُ, is because we socialize with one another. As Allah has created us, subhanahu wa ta'ala, we can't live independent from one another. No one can live by themselves. The way for us to exist and to be is that we need one another. If I want to provide for my family, I have to have human beings around me, or else I wouldn't survive. So everybody is in need of what's in the hand of another person. And because of that, the Sharia permitted what is known as bay'ah, transactions, made conditions as stipulated, because buying and selling is how I can get from you what you have without oppressing you, without wronging you, and you can get the money that I have in my hand. You have product that I need. By giving you this money, you will surrender your belongings, and I will surrender my money. So we are, in that way, we coexist, and we comfort one another. We socialize with one another. Yeah. Then the Shaykh rahimahullah, when he brought the ayah, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ, I did not create the jinn, وَالْإِنْسَ, and ins, إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, except to worship me. The Shaykh says, وَمَعْنَا, and the meaning of يَعْبُدُونَ is يُوَحِّدُونِي. The meaning that is in يَعْبُدُونِي, to worship me, is يُوَحِّدُونِي, is to single me in worship. So it doesn't mean that you just worship Allah. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنْسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. It doesn't mean just to worship Allah, that Allah created you for you to worship Him. Rather, what the correct meaning is, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, He created the jinn and He created the ins to single Him in worship. What does ifrad bil ibadah mean? Huh? It means the tawheed. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنْسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, أي يوحدون, right? That's what tawheed is. يوحدون is tawheed. ولذلك there's a hadith al-Imam al-Tirmidhi narrated in his Jami', Ibn Majah narrated in his Sunan, Ahmad narrated in his Musnad, on the authority of Ma'qal ibn Yasar. Al-Imam al-Hakim al-Naysaburi also brought it in his Mustadrak, and Tabarani brought it in his Mu'jam. that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the narration that I'm bringing is the one brought from the hadith of Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu. That's in Tirmidhi's and Ibn Majah and Ahmed. There's also one narrated, the meaning is narrated, there's another hadith that holds the same meaning that's narrated from Ma'qal ibn Yasar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. But this one's not the Ma'qal ibn Yasar narration, it is Abu Huraira's narration. And this hadith is very powerful. It's a hadith al-Qudsi. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Yabna Adam, the children of Adam, tafarrag, tafarrag li'ibadati. O the children of Adam, free yourself for my worship. Free yourself meaning get rid of everything else that's preoccupying you. Get rid of it. And come free when you're worshipping me. What would Allah do for you in return? أَمْلَأُ صَدْرَكَ غِنًا. I will fill your chest with richness. I will enrich you. وَأَسُدُّ فَقْرَكَ. And I will block off poverty from you. I'll protect poverty from you. I will take it on myself, Allah is saying subhanahu wa ta'ala, to make you rich and to get rid of poverty from you. وَإِلَّا تَفْعَلْ. And if you don't do that, مَلَأْتُ صَدْرَكَ شُغْلًا. I will preoccupy your chest. Busy you. وَلَمْ أَسُدَّ. And I will not get rid of your poverty. فَقَرَكَ your poverty. And if you look at a lot of people today and you observe their situation, what is he? Jifun billayli himarun binnahari. He's like a dead corpse. He's like a dead animal, a dead corpse at night time when he's sleeping. He sleeps on one side, he doesn't even turn around, doesn't toss around, how tired he is. Himarun binnahari, all day is like a donkey the way he works. If you look at the reason behind that, is because he comes at night time home and he combines all his prayers. He doesn't وَلَا يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. He doesn't remember Allah except little. He didn't make himself free for Allah's worship. He didn't give Allah tabarak wa ta'ala time. He consistently busied himself with worldly gain. I have to work, I have to provide, I need to make money, I need to, dunya, dunya, dunya. So what did Allah place in his heart? His heart got filled up with what? Shughlan, he's preoccupied, he's busy, consistently. And the faqr and the poverty is non-stop. He doesn't have no money at the end of the month. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, in his Majmu' al-Fatawa, the 15th volume, page 25, he says a very powerful statement. And this is a concept that I've been telling people. But ponder and look at what he says here, rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'ah. And try to analyze it properly and understand. Don't look far. Don't try to look at somebody else. Try to look at yourself. Where do you fall in this situation? Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he says, Man tadabbara ahwal al-alam. Anyone who observes the situation of the universe today, he realizes, wajada kullu salah fil ard. He finds that all success and prosperity on this earth, fasababuhu tawheedullah, it is due to Allah's tawheed. Wa'ibadatu, and it's the worship of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Every success you've ever heard of, and prosperity and good on the face of this earth, the reason for it is Tawheedullah, Allah has been worshipped, subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala's ubudiyya was in place. Wa ta'at wa rasulihi sallallahu alayhi wa sallama, and the obedience of the messenger alayhi salatu wa salam. And the Shaykh says, wa kullu sharrin, and every evil fil alami, in this universe if you observe it. Wa fitna, and every trials and tribulation if you observe it. Wa ba, and also wa bala, wa qahd, wa tasliit adu, and the enemies causing harm to a people, the drought, wa ghayri dhalika, and other than that. فَسَبَبُهُ, the reason for it is مُخَالَفَةَ الرَّسُولِ, the Prophet was opposed. وَالدَّعْوَةُ إِلَىٰ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ, supplication to other than Allah. وَمَنْ تَدَبَّرَ هَذَا حَقَّ التَّدَبُّرِ, anyone who analyzes that and ponders on that as it deserves for it to be pondered on. وَجَدَ هَذَا الْأَمْرِ, you would find that this matter كَذَلِكَ is as I have told you. فِي خَاصَةِ نَفْسِهِ, the inner within yourself. وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. The Shaykh says, وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. Then the Shaykh rahimahullah, he says, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab rahimahullah, وأعظم ما أمر الله به التوحيد وهو إفراد الله بالعبادة. The greatest thing that Allah تبارك وتعالى commanded, the greatest thing which Allah تبارك وتعالى has commanded is توحيد. There's nothing greater than توحيد. Tawheed in the language is مَزْدَر, it's a verbal noun of the word وَحَّدَ, يُوَحِّدُ تَوْحِيدًا, أي جَعَلَهُ وَاحِدًا لَا ثَانِيَ لَهُ, is to make something single, it is to make something one. Now a question I'm going to ask you, and I want you to think about this question, it's a rhetorical question, you don't need to answer it. Question is, what do you do based on the word I just gave you? I said مَزْدَرْ وَحَّدَ يُوَحِّدُ تَوْحِيدًا, A, جَعَلَهُ وَاحِدًا, is to make Allah one, right? Is it you who goes and makes Allah, only one Allah? Are you the one that goes out there and makes Allah only one Allah and no other Allah? Is that the one, is that what you do? Is it you that the one that goes there and makes only one Allah to be basically that exists and there's no other Allah? You get rid of all the other Allahs, all the other gods. Is that what you do? Is that what it means? مَزْدَرُ وَحَّدَ يُوَحِّدُ تَوْحِيدًا أَيْ جَعَلَهُ وَاحِدًا لَا ثَانِيَ لَهُ. Is that what it means? The answer is no. No, no, no. That's not what it means. Because making Allah one is the reality. حَقِيقَةِ الْأَمْرِ is not what we're speaking about. But rather what's being spoken about is what's in your heart and your belief. Are you with me? And that's the difference between اعتقاد and علم. Are you with me? A belief is when you hold on to something with unwavering conviction and there's a possibility it could be right or wrong. Whereas knowledge is mutabaqatul waqa. Whereas knowledge, on the other hand, it's actually in accordance to the reality. So when we say that tawheed is mazdar yuwahhida yuwahhidu tawheedan, we mean ija'alahu wahidan, it means ay fi qalbika, in your heart, that you believe that there is one God, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, that there's one creator, one sustainer, one provider, one who deserves to be worshipped alone and not associated partners with him in his ibadah. Are you with me? And what is it that you single him in Allah tabarak wa ta'ala? You single him in what? Three things. You single Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in the actions that Allah does subhanahu wa ta'ala, af'aluh. Are you there? You also single him subhanahu wa ta'ala in the actions that you do, such as your dua, your khawf, your dhabh, the supplications that you make, the fear that you come with, the slaughtering that you do, the oath that you make. All of that is actions that you come as a creation with. You single him in it. And you also single him, the first one was what? You single him in the actions that he does subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is al-khalqu wal-mulku wal-tadbiru, that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala creates. So that's an action that Allah does. You single him in it. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he sustains and he provides. That's an action Allah does. You single him in it. Good. The third thing is, you single Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in his names and attributes. You single Allah in the names and the attributes which he has. For instance, Allah has the name Ar-Rahman. This name Ar-Rahman has a meaning in it. It's not just a mere name. It is not mujarrad a'lam. It's not just a mere name. So it has a characteristics in it. It has a meaning in it. You affirm the meaning that is in it, which is sifatul rahmah, that Allah is merciful. Now what you do is, this mercy that Allah has, is it like the mercy of the creation? No. You single him in that mercy. You single him in that characteristics. You single him in that name, Ar-Rahman. Okay? So that's what it means when we say, أي جعله واحدا, he made it one. وهو, and the Sheikh says, وهو إفراد الله, and it is to single Allah تبارك وتعالى بالعبادة. But which one, pay attention here, is the one from the three that I just mentioned right now that we have to single Allah in? There is a fourth thing that we need to single Allah in that I was about to forget. There's a fourth thing that you need to single Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in, is Allah tabarak wa ta'ala's that, Allah's essence. You don't believe that there's two gods. Okay? You single him in that, subhanahu wa ta'ala. That divinity, okay? That he, this, that, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, there's nothing like him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's only one Allah. Okay? So you single him in his that, you single him in his actions that he does, subhanahu wa ta'ala. You single him in the actions that you do as a creation. You single him in his names and attributes. Those four things. Okay? Now the question that arises is, which of those four that I mentioned is the one that has become the longest debated one? The one that the argument, that the discussion, that the hellfire was made for, the Jannah was made for, which is the one that the mankind and the children of Adam have always denied, generations after generation, is the one which is them singling Allah in the actions that they do. You singling Allah in your actions. That's the one that has become the longest debated, argued one. Singling Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in your dua. Singling Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in your fear. Singling Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in the slaughter and the oath that you make. Singling Allah in the prayer that you pray. Singling Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in the fasting that you fast. Singling Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in the charity that you give. Singling Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in the pilgrimage to the Kaaba that you do. All of those are things that prophets came for and people were denying and they were refusing to do. From Nabiullah Nuh's time until today, the biggest long discussed and the biggest argument is based upon singling Allah in the action that the slave does. And that's the one that the Sheikh mentioned. He says, وَأَعْظَمُ. So because of that, it became the greatest one. وَأَعْظَمُ, the greatest of that which Allah commanded in Tawheed is huwa ifradullahi bil ibadati, is to single Allah in your actions, O slave. To single Allah in your actions. Walidhalika, and because of that, because it has become the longest debated and it's become the longest argued concept, some scholars have actually defined Tawheed to just mean that one. Because the rest, they've been accepted. There was no debate and argument about it. The one that has been argued about is what? Singling Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in worship, in our fasting, in our zakat, in our hajj, in our sawm, and etc. Because it has become that one, some scholars, when they define Tawheed, they just refer to it as what? Ifradullahi bil ibadah. Singling Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in worship. And it is from the greatest things that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala commanded. And it is because of it Allah sent messengers down. And because of it Allah sent down books. And because of it Allah legislated jihad. And this is the one that is known as Tawheedul Uluhiyya. It is known as Tawheedul Uluhiyya. It means that you single Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in your speech, O slave. You single Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in your action, O slave. And you also single Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in your intentions and your motives. All of those three you single him in it, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's what the author means by it. When you're singling Allah in it, you do it in a state of complete love and complete humiliation. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has two types of ibadah. And there are two types of ibadah that are mentioned in the Quran. There is ibadah which is a ibadah which is shar'i, and there's an ibadah which is kawni. The ibadah which is kawniyun, which is the universal ubudiyya, the universal servitude, that one no one can deny. Everyone is a slave of Allah, whether they like it or not, whether they agree or disagree. And that's the one Allah refers to in Surah Maryam, ayah 93. In kullu man fi samawati wal ardi illa atir rahmani abda. That every single thing on this earth and every single thing in the heaven will come to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala as a slave. This is ubudiyatul kawniyya. It's the universal servitude. The disbeliever will come that day and is a slave, whether he likes it or not. The believer will come the day of judgment as a slave. But that's not the one Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is referring to when he says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. The one that's meant here, illa liya'budun, is the ubudiyatu shar'iyya, the ikhtiyari one, the one you choose to, the one you single Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in worship. Then the author, rahimahullah, he says, وَأَعْظَمُ مَا نَهَى عَنْهُ الشِّرْكُ. The greatest thing that Allah commanded, what is it? At-tawheed. And what does it mean? Huwa ifradullahi bil ibadah, is to single Allah in worship. The opposite is what is the greatest thing that Allah prohibited. وَأَعْظَمُ مَا نَهَى عَنْهُ الشِّرْكُ. The greatest thing which Allah has prohibited is shirk. The word shirk, in the linguistic meaning, in the Arabic language, it comes from it means the word an-nasib. Portion. So what it means is that أشرك مع الله غيره, he has associated partners with Allah تبارك وتعالى. What it means, أي جعل لغيره نصيبا, he has made for other than Allah a portion. That is the greatest thing that Allah has prohibited, subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's nothing greater than the prohibition of shirk. based on the hadith Al-Imam Al-Bukhari narrated and Imam Muslim narrated on the authority of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, Sa'altu, I asked. And some narrations say, Su'ila, the messenger was asked. So Sa'altu is Mabniyu lil Ma'loom. The person who's asking is Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. Su'ila, which is Mabniyu lil Majhul. Dhumma awwaluhu wa kusira ma qabla akhirihi. Su'ila, he was asked. This is Mabniyu lil Majhul. The person who's asking is not known. The messenger was asked, Ayyu dhanbi indallahi a'zam. Which sin is most greatest to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala? In another wording, it says, Ayyu dhanbi indallahi akbar. The messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, An taj'ala lillahi niddan wa huwa khalaqaka. It is to associate partners with Allah when He is the one who created you. And also the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Mu'adh, Atadri ma haqqu Allahi ala ibadihi. Mu'adh, do you know the rights of Allah on His slave? Mu'adh responded by saying, Allahu wa rasuluhu a'lam, Allah and His messenger know best. The messenger responded by saying, حق الله على عباده أن يعبدوه ولا يشركوا به شيئا. The rights of Allah on His slave is, they worship Him alone, and they do not associate partners with Him whatsoever. Al-Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim both narrated it. That hadith has indicated and it has shown us that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has rights on His slaves. And anyone who forsakes that and abandons that right that are placed on his shoulder, then he has surely fallen short on the greatest responsibility that was on him. وَهُوَ and it is, Shaykh Muhammad Abdul Wahab goes on to say it, وَهُوَ and it is. What does he mean, wahuwa? What's he talking about? A shirk. He's talking about the shirk. This is the definition. The statement that the Shaykh is saying here right now is ta'rifu shirk. He's going to define what shirk means. Wahuwa, and it is da'watu ghayrihi ma'ahu. It is to supplicate ghayrihi besides Allah ma'ahu with him. This is the definition of the Shaykh Rahimahullah, which is ta'rifu shirk. He's defining what shirk is. Shirk means it is to make with Allah tabarak wa ta'ala an ilah. It can be an angel. It can be a messenger. It can be a wali. It can be a stone. It can be a human being. It doesn't matter. You worship it like you worship Allah. Such as you supplicate to it. You seek aid and support and refuge from them. You slaughter for them. You swear by them and make an oath on them. Then this is shirkul akbar, the major shirk. And it is four types. It is four types. The shirk. It's four types. Shirk can be looked at from many different angles. اعتبارات مختلفة. You can look at it from many different angles. The most common one is shirk akbar and shirk asghar. صح? And that when we mention the hadith, Al-Imam Hakim al-Naysaburi mentions in his Mustadrak, من سنده, from his chain of narration to who Shaddad ibn Awsir رضي الله تعالى عنه, he said, كنا نعد في عهد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الرياء من شرك الأصغر. That we used to consider showing off at the time of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, we used to consider it to be what? شرك أصغر, the minor shirk. So the Sahabas, they used to believe the concept of شرك أكبر and شرك أصغر. That was something present amongst them. Shaddad ibn Aws is a companion رضي الله تعالى عنه. And when he says kunna na'uddu, this takes what? Mawqufu lafdan marfu'u hukman. It is mawquf, meaning it stops at Shaddad ibn Awsin, but it takes the hukum of Rafa. It takes the hukum of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam saying it. Because this is called a taqreer. The Prophet consented to it, alayhi salatu wasalam. We're not talking about that categorization right now. We're talking about another categorization of shirk. This categorization of shirk is four types. The first type is called shirk al-du'a. The first one is called shirk al-du'a, the shirk of supplication. And that is when the person supplicates and he calls on to other than Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. It could be a prophet, min nabiyyin, or malak, or it can be an angel, or wali, or it can even be a wali of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And he gets, and the way he does it is either by salah, are you there? Or either by istighatha or isti'ana, or he supplicates to him whilst he's dead. This person is not even present, he's dead in his grave, or he's absent. This is called shirk al-du'a. And this is all uniquely rights of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. He is the one who should be supplicated to, and he is the one who should be called on to. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, فَإِذَا رَكِبُوا فِي الْفُلْكِ دَعَوُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ فَلَمَّا نَجَّاهُمْ إِلَى الْبَرِّ إِذَا هُمْ يُشْرِكُونَ. Surah Al-Ankabut, ayah 65. Allah says, when they are on the boat, and then a tide, right, comes to them from different angles, and they are about to drown, دَعَوُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ. They supplicate to Allah, and they call on to Him with sincerity in the religion. Allah then says, فَلَمَّا نَجَّاهُمْ, when we save them to the shore, إِذَا هُمْ يُشْرِكُونَ, Allah says they do shirk. Allahu Akbar. Allah says that they do shirk. إِذَا هُمْ يُشْرِكُونَ. So Allah referred to them calling onto other than Allah shirk. The second one is shirk al-niyyati wal-iradati wal-qasd. This one is called the shirk of intentions, motives, wills that the person has. It's basically when a person comes with a ibadah and he does it to show off, or he does it for worldly reasons. He does it because he either wants to gain reputation from it, he wants to get fame from it, or whatnot. And this is the one Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says in Surah Hud, ayah 15 to ayah 16. Man kana yuridu al-hayat al-dunya wa zinataha nuwaffi ilayhim a'malahum fiha wa hum fiha la yubkhasoon. أولئك الذين ليس لهم في الآخرة إلا النار وحبط ما صنعوا فيها وباطل ما كانوا يعملون. Whoever wants the life of this dunya and its beauty, then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala tells him that his actions will be taken. If you are basically a person who is doing this for worldly reasons, you're running after the glitters and the glamours of this world, Allah says, you know what? We'll actually give you what you want from this dunya. If you're doing it for worldly reasons, you'll get it. If you're looking to become a qadi, you're learning the religion so you can become a qadi, a judge, and that's the motive that you have. You only dunya reasons. You're not learning it lillah. Are you there? Or you want to become an imam, and that's your goal. You want to stand in front of the people so you can do khutbah, and that's it. Or you just want, you know, to mock the people and show them how ignorant they are and how knowledgeable you are. If that's your reason behind it, or you want to get more money from it and people to give you money, then if that's what you're doing it for, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala might give you that position that you're running after. You might get it. But the day of judgment, you have nothing. Allah says, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ لَيْسَ لَهُمْ فِي الْآخِرَةِ إِلَّا النَّارِ. The day of judgment, you have nothing except the hellfire. وَحَبِطَ مَا صَلَعُوا فِيهَا وَبَاطِلٌ. And every single thing that you have done, it will be nullified. It will be null and void. Nothing will exist from it. مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. Everything which they used to do. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, in his book Al-Jawab al-Kafi liman sa'ala 'an ad-dawa' al-shafi, which is also known as Ad-Da' wa Ad-Dawa', Here Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he says, أَمَّا الشِّرْكُ فِي الْإِرَادَاتِ وَالنِّيَّاتِ. He's talking about this type of shirk, which is the shirk of intentions and motives. He says, فَذَلِكَ الْبَحْرُ الَّذِي لَا سَاحِلَ لَهُ. This one is, it's an ocean that has no shore, meaning it has no ending point. Meaning, قَلَّ مَنْ يَنْجُو مِنْهُ, he says. It's very little whoever is saved from this one. This one, not many people are saved from it. فَمَنْ أَرَادَ بِعَمَلِهِ غَيْرَ وَجْهِ اللَّهِ. Anybody who wants through his actions other than the face of Allah, وَنَوَى شَيْئًا, and he intends something, غَيْرَ التَّقَرُّبِ إِلَيْهِ, without getting close to him subhanahu wa ta'ala. He intends something other than getting closer to Allah. He doesn't want to get closer to Allah. He wants something else. وَطَلَبَ الْجَزَاءَ مِنْهُ, and he requests for a reward for what he does. He says, please pay me for my reward. فَقَدْ أَشْرَكَ فِي نِيَتِهِ وَإِرَادَتِهِ. He has fallen into shirk in his intention and his irada. Subhanallah. And subhanallah, if you today ponder and you analyze, you see that so many people today, through the da'wah that they're giving, the da'wah that they are giving, they want to actually charge people for it. They want to get make money out of it. The da'i will call and say, I'm going to come to this event. If you guys want me to come, I have to have 7-star hotel or 5-star hotel. I have to sleep in a 5-star hotel. This, my plane has to be a business flight I have to be on, or a first class. Okay. I have to be given this much money for the couple of days I'm going to be there. Yani, it is all... يريد الحياة الدنيا from it وزينتها. The third type is called shirk الطاعة, the shirk of obedience. It's called shirk الطاعة. Shirk الطاعة is a person takes a legislator and he permits it for himself. أن يتخذ مشرعا سوى الله تعالى. He takes a legislator besides Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. And he gives the authority and the rights and makes it permissible, and it makes it permissible for this individual to legislate, and says it's permissible, halal for you to legislate. And he becomes pleased with that person's hukum. Just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Surah At-Tawbah, ayah 31, اتخذوا أحبارهم ورهبانهم أربابا من دون الله والمسيح ابن مريم وما أمروا إلا ليعبدوا إلها واحدا لا إله إلا هو سبحانه عما يشركون. That they took their rabbis and their monks, أربابا, they took them as lords, besides Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. When that verse came down, the noble companion Adi ibn Hatim radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he recited this verse. And he was a man who knew his religion very well previously. And he said to the Prophet, Messenger of Allah, Inna lasna na'buduhum, we never used to worship them. The Prophet then sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to them, him, Alaysa yuharrimuna ma ahalla Allahu fatuharrimuna. Were they not making haram for you guys that which Allah has made halal, and then you made it haram based on what they said? وَيُحِلُّونَ مَا حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ فَتُحِلُّونَ. And you made halal that which Allah made haram, and then you made halal based on what they said? And Adi said, yes, we did that. Then the Prophet said, فَتِلْكَ عِبَادَتُهُمْ, you worship them. You gave them the rights of tashri' to legislate. Made it halal for them. Just like this noble narration mentions. His noble companion now understood it. The Prophet said, فَتِلْكَ عِبَادَتُهُمْ, you worship them. It's shirk al-ta'a. Which is the issue of istihlal, of the issue of at-tashri'a. Number four, which is shirk al-mahabba. Shirk al-mahabba. It is to take andad, things besides Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, from the creation. The person loves them the way they love Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Your wife can fall under this. Oh. Or even the husband can fall under this for a wife. If she puts her, if she loves her husband the way she loves Allah, فَيُقَدِّمُ طَاعَتَهُمْ عَلَىٰ طَاعَتِي, and she gives precedence to the obedience of her husband over Allah, or vice versa, the husband gives precedence to his the obedience of his wife over Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, then this falls under shirkul mahabba, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the ayah Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah 165, ومن الناس من يتخذ من دون الله أندادا يحبونهم كحب الله. From the people are those who have taken besides Allah تبارك وتعالى أنداد. They love them the way they love Allah تبارك وتعالى. You see, لذلك ابن القيم رحمه الله in his كتاب الداء والدواء, which is also known as الجواب الكافي لمن سأل عن الدواء الشافي, he mentions that the محبة, the love, when he was commenting on this verse, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَتَّخِذُ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ أَنْدَادًا يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ, he mentions that the love is of four types. So one can go to that book of his, page 164. And he expands on it over there, رحمه الله تعالى. Then the author, he says, وَالدَّلِيلُ قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى, what does the Shaykh mean with Dalilu Qawlu Ta'ala? Dalil for what? Dalil that the greatest thing that Allah commanded is ibadah, and the greatest thing that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala prohibited was shirk. This is the evidence for it now. What is the evidence? That the greatest thing that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala commanded was Tawheed. And what's the evidence? That the greatest thing that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala prohibited was shirk. What's the evidence for that? This is the ayah for it. وَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ, worship Allah تبارك وتعالى. وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا, and do not associate partners with him. So هذه الآية جمعت بين الأمرين. This verse has combined between two things. What is it? الأمر بالعبادة, commanding you to worship Allah alone سبحانه وتعالى. والنهي عن الشرك, and prohibiting you from associating partners with him سبحانه وتعالى. What's this ayah showing you? That you cannot come with true ibadah unless you stay away from shirk. The minimum of it and the large of it. The maximum of shirk and the minimum of it. Both of them you have to stay away from. Where's the evidence for that? وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا. شَيْئًا is نَكِرَةٌ فِي سِيَاقِ النَّهِيِ. تُفِيدُ الْعُمُومِ صح؟ So you have to stay away from the little amount of shirk, and you also have to stay away from the large amount of shirk, and that, and then come with ibadah, then you are incorrect. You're on the straight path. Are you there? Very good. We will conclude there, inshallah ta'ala. And Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, his muqaddimah finishes there, the third muqaddimah. Inshallah ta'ala, next lesson we will go into the sulbul kitab. And Shaykh now goes into the book. He goes into the book, which he speaks about the three fundamentals, the three questions that you will be asked in your grave. The Shaykh goes in now. This was all an introduction. This was all an introduction. We will go into the Sulbul Kitab, inshallah ta'ala, next lesson, bi'idhni Allah al-Kareem. Anything which I have said that was wrong and incorrect is from me and Shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik, ashadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.